Tony here, guitar player with the Clone Roses. I've had a couple of requests on Twitter for a video showing some of my guitars, the rig, and maybe do a playthrough of a song. Now, I'm not usually that keen, I'll be honest, on social media stuff, and making videos isn't really my thing. But with no gigs at the moment, I thought I'd make the effort and throw something together for those of you that are interested. So here we go. Okay, first up is my favourite guitar, bought for me on my 18th birthday by my mum and dad. It's a USA Strat. I actually started playing when I was 8, but my dad was also guitar mad and he had a number of guitars, so we always played my dad's guitars when I was younger, really. He was a Fender enthusiast, so I grew up playing his Strats and Tellies, and when I was turning 18, my parents mentioned about getting a guitar for me. And so I too wanted a Stratocaster. I think we got this one, I'm pretty sure we got this one actually, from Penny Lane Music in Liverpool. I'm not sure if it's still there, that shop anymore, but it was a fantastic shop. I hope it's still there. I used this guitar in the early days of the Clone Roses. I remember as our audiences started to grow, getting really annoyed as beer got thrown in high spirits and this guitar got covered in beer, so it's not a problem anymore as I don't use this guitar anymore with the Clone Roses. I've not played it for a long time actually. It probably needs a bit of setting up, like I say, but yeah, that's my go-to guitar if whenever I play in bands that aren't Clone Roses. That's one that I usually try and utilize whenever I can, because I don't get a chance to play it much. Anyway, as we got better as a band and started to do some slightly bigger shows, we really thought we needed to make the effort to ensure the visual element of the show was up to scratch. We needed to do more than just have our Gav, who plays Ian, putting the Ian Brown Money t-shirt on. So we endeavoured to try and recreate the Blackpool Live show by having the instruments they played on Blackpool Live. And so that meant us having to buy this beauty. A Gretsch Country Classic. It's a modern remake of the vintage Country Gents, but still quite expensive. Didn't want our folks to know how much we paid for it, so essentially we hid this guitar from them and had a code word for it, called it the G, whenever we were discussing it. We got this one from Frailer's Guitars in Runcorn, great shop. Again, not sure if it's still there, but I think it is actually. I'll be honest, when I first started playing it, I didn't really like it. When you're used to the contours of a Strat and then you have to put this on, it felt very clunky. I found it hard to control the sound, it's hollow body. So you get a lot of feedback, which is great for the atmospheric bits at the start of a Dord, but not at other times. But eventually you got used to it and I really like it now. I hadn't played it for a long time, as the current show we do is based on the most recent Roses performances. But it got an outing last year when we played the Blackpool Empress Ballroom and did the Blackpool Live Show, possibly my favourite gig of all time. And hopefully we'll get a chance to do that again at some point. So that's the Gretsch Country Classic. Okay, so next up, those guitars I've just shown you, the Strat and the Gretsch, are the two guitars I used mainly at the start of the time with the band. But prior to Blackpool Live last year, I thought rather than going with my Strat, we'd get a pink one, which is similar to what John Squire played at Blackpool Live. So yeah, this is what I bought for that. It's not a Fender, it's a Squire copy. Most of my guitars are copy. I'll explain a bit about that later. But yeah, a bit battered up as well, but pretty good guitar. It's my daughter's favourite guitar. I think she'll like this one. If she decides to learn guitar, she'll probably end up playing this one. But yeah, we bought this to replicate the pink Strat that John played, so there's that one. Just needed a bit of setting up, really. It sounds fine. Okay, now a lot changed in 2012 when the Roses got back together for the Heaton Park shows. We got tickets for the Saturday. yeah, we bought them. Loads of people always ask, did you get free tickets? And I was like, no. Why would we? We're not mates with them. met Manny a couple of times, that's about it. I remember leading up to the show just being obsessed about how they were going to sound and what it might mean for us as a band. Would they sound like they did in the Blackpool shows? because we had the VHS video of the Blackpool live show, and was it going to sound like that, or were they going to go in a different direction? And I had a mate actually who went to see the Friday night show, and he reported back to me that John's guitar sound was a lot chunkier and really rocky, a bit more distortion and overdrive. So I kind of knew what to expect. As soon as he launched into that riff for Adored, though, I knew we're going to be adapting our sound, and our band was going to go in the direction of mimicking the Roses as they were at Heaton Park, just to give that, it was just a fantastic vibe, that gig. And so that was the excuse to rethink some of the equipment to use and some of the guitars. At the same time, I was getting increasingly fed up with taking expensive guitars on the road. And so I decided to just use cheaper versions, the Squire copies and the Epiphone copies. And most of my guitars from now on are actually eBay purchases. So first up is this imitation black and white Strat. John's was a bit bashed up, and he had the lyrics to Waterfall written on the base of the guitar. So basically, I just went on eBay, had a look for a black and white Strat that met the spec, got it home, got a Tippex pen, and Tippex the lyrics. In fact, on the back, I think, oh, it's scratched off. There was a little bit where I said, I was testing it worked, and just put test on the back. So that is simply a Tippex pen. It's actually wearing away here, so I'll have to redo that. And to give the bashed up look, I just got a chisel and some sandpaper, and it didn't really turn out that great, to be honest with you, but from a distance, it looks all right. And like I say, just getting it home, looking at what I didn't like about putting my strings on. I used 10s and just redoing the setup and the truss rod so it all fits my playing style, and use that for a good number of years as well. So that's really like that one. Next up, there's a number of songs that at Heaton Park where he played a Les Paul, and so another eBay purchase was this Epiphone Les Paul. I had to travel down to Stafford to collect this one. Again, needed a little bit of setting up. I've not really played Les Pauls before, but I just love the chunkiness of the sound and the humbucker pickups. It was a bit strange at first, being a Fender player all my life. I felt a little bit like I was being unfaithful to Strats by playing a Les Paul. Yeah, it's really silly. I still use this nowadays. I use it on Love Spreads, as Love Spreads is played in a different tuning. It's open D tuning. So this just stays tuned to open D, and it's just used for that song. In fact, not played with it. Let's see if it is still open D. A little bit out of tune, but not far off. Yep, so that's the Les Paul. So with those guitars for a good few years, and then when the Roses again got back together to do the shows at the Etihad and the Bigger World tour, I looked at getting hold of a black 3 pickup Les Paul. Again, this is Epiphone copy. Again, it was an eBay purchase. I really like this guitar, actually, and this is the one that I use more or less for nearly every song now nowadays. Love the sound it gets me. This is what we use on our whenever we're doing the most recent Roses show, apart from Love Spreads, which I use the Les Paul that I showed you a moment ago. But yeah, fantastic. Sometimes I feel it's a bit over the top with high gain, but those 3 humbucker pickups just make it sound massive. So yeah, love that guitar, and that's my main axe of choice at the moment. Lastly is this Jaguar, which we got ready for the Spike Island show, which didn't happen but will happen one day. Now the guitar John played at Spike Island was a custom built Jaguar. He had one, this kind of sunbursty effect. He had a white one as well. And they used the body of a bass, I think it was a jazz bass, and the neck of a guitar, and it was kind of like custom built for him. Now, I didn't have the time, the skills, or the patience to build one of those replica guitars. I might do one day. So we bought this as a bit of a close imitation, and I'm going to change the scratch plate to white, and maybe change the machine heads, which I like to do with a lot of guitars, just make sure they're solid and stay in tune. And this is the guitar that I just have on a stand at home that I just grab and play when I get the chance. Plays really nice. Still not really worked out what all the different switches and knobs do, I'll be honest. But I'll play this one for you on a bit of a track at the end, which I've been working on, ready for Spike Island. So that's the last guitar. Okay, onto amps. In the early days, I used an old Spring Reverb amp that was my dad's, and I went on then to use a really, really fantastic Music Man vintage valve head, which is still at my dad's. It's fantastic. That sounded amazing, but I didn't like that amp through a 4x12. It just sounded a bit muddy, so I used it through a small 1x12 Marshall cabinet, and it sounded great, did the job great. It looked a bit weird though, because the amp head itself was wider than the speaker, so it looked a bit strange, but it did a great job. Then when we changed sounds for the Heat and Part shows, I really wanted to scale down my rig. I was thinking if there was a way of getting great sound without having to lug around big heavy amps. Now, I'm sure this might upset a few of the purists, but as a result, my current sound is now 100% digital. There's no amps used. Any amps you see behind me on stage I use just for backup. No sound comes out of them. For a few years, I played through a MacBook running Amplitube. And yet all of those sounds came out of a computer. I used a Behringer MIDI pedal to control me changes live, and that worked fine. The only problem was that there was a lot that could go wrong, so I was constantly on edge thinking something was going to crash or fail in some way. And there was this one show in particular, we went over to Belfast to play the Ulster Hall. I had to travel quite light, so only took my guitars and the MacBook. I left the pedal at home, and what I did whenever I needed to do a change, like kicking an overdrive or a phaser, I cut out little rectangles of paper, label them distortion, phaser, delay, and would just put them on the floor in front of me. And whenever I needed to kick one of the effects in, I pressed the piece of paper with my foot, and my guitar tech Lee from Lee would be on the laptop side of the stage, watch what I was tapping, and he'd just use the mouse on the MacBook to activate the effects. It was really mad to think about, really. It was a massive gig, iconic venue, and I'm there tapping torn up pieces of paper on stage with my foot. Nowadays, I use an all-in-one amp modeler and effects unit. This is a Line 6 unit, which I've got used to and started carrying on using it. You'll see I've constructed a little box to cover and protect the area where all my connections go. And of course, we've got the plastic sheet to protect it from the flying beer. I also like to make my own flight cases to protect the gear, my gear. So this one's sitting in one of my custom cases. It's fantastic. I've got it set up in stereo, so the left PA gets a slightly different sound to the right PA. But when you put it together, makes it sound really big and wide. So yeah, it's all digital, no amps, and as a result, the stage volume can be kept really quite reasonable. I hear myself through my in-ear monitors, which are, these are molded to the shape of my ears, which is good. And the monitor engineer sends my monitor mix direct to them instead of a traditional wedge. I love it, it's great sound quality, it's clear as a bell, not too loud. Our Gav, the singer's tried him, but he's not really keen, as you lose a bit of the atmosphere of the gig and the connection with the audience, but they work for me. I know Baggy, our bass player, uses them as well, and there's just Gav, singer, and Phil, who plays Rennie, who use traditional wedges. So that's it. I'll finish off playing a track for you. In the lead up to the Spike Island show, I was working on One Love, which is a song I think we've only played live a handful of times, and it was some time ago. So sorry in advance for the guitar tone. I've kept it simple and just using a plug-in through my computer. So hope some of you found it interesting. Any questions, drop me a message on Twitter, at Clone Squire, and leave comments here if you like, but I'll be honest, probably won't read them. People who look after our social media might see them, but Twitter's probably where you find me, and even then I'm not on there that much. So yeah, take care, and hopefully catch you at a gig sometime soon. Bye bye.